Turn our Bibles to Proverbs chapter 4. If everyone would turn there, I would like to read actually the whole book of Proverbs, not the whole book, that whole chapter. I don't want to scare you. I want to read that whole chapter to you. Because we're talking about running the race, and if you didn't see the first message a couple weeks ago, it is on the live stream or on the YouTube account. You can watch it, or you can always listen to it, audio podcast as well. But run the race, number two. I've seen some crazy people out there, not just running in the snow, I've seen them riding their bikes. You know you live in Portland with people that are riding their bikes, right? In the snow, like they go downtown and they rent those little, what color are they? Little orange, yellowish, orange bikes, and the guy's renting the bike and going down the street. I'm like, really? How do you get through the snow on a bike? I don't know. He's like, he was being interviewed by Channel 4. They're like, well, it has fat tires. I'm like, okay, we'll see how far you go. Interesting. But we all have a race to run, and that first message was really foundational. So listen to that this afternoon and pull it up on your computer. But as I was reading Proverbs chapter 4, I saw that it really relates to the race. And multiple times in Proverbs chapter 4, it talks about the path. So we all have to follow the path in order to run the race and stay on the path if we ever intend to not just finish the race, but intend to win. The path that he laid out before us ahead of time. That's what the message was all about last week. The main theme of that is that God has a path for us and he has marked the course out before us ahead of time. It's our job to find out where that path is. His will, not our will, like Brittany was talking about. His plan, not our plan. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. His ways are higher than our ways. And his plan for our life is really the ultimate plan that is going to be the most successful and the most fulfilling in our lives here on this earth. God has a plan. And so we look at the book of Proverbs, and the book of Proverbs, obviously written by Solomon. Remember the prayer that Solomon could ask God for anything, and what did he ask for? He asked for wisdom. So God gave him wisdom, and that wisdom is here written in this whole book of Proverbs. So this is direct wisdom from heaven as a direct answer to Solomon's prayer. Solomon wrote this book to teach his kids. It was an instruction manual. It was like a children's church curriculum, Sunday school curriculum. So he wrote it to teach his kids, and he would sit down with his son. He would talk to his son. He would go over things with them, and he would just teach him wisdom from heaven. Because God had downloaded this incredible wisdom by the Holy Spirit into his heart, into his mind. And from that, we are blessed to have this book today. And so this chapter, chapter 4, one of the most, you know, profound book of Proverbs that there is, this chapter says, it says, listen, my sons, he's teaching his kids, to a father's instruction. Pay attention and gain understanding. I give you sound learning, so do not forsake my teaching. For I, too, was a son to my father. His father being David, right? Still tender and cherished by my mother. Then he taught me and he said to me, take hold of my words with your heart. Keep my commands and you will live. Get wisdom, get understanding. Do not forget my words or turn away from them. Do not forsake wisdom and she, every time he uses the word she, he's talking about wisdom. It says, do not forsake wisdom, and she, wisdom, will protect you. Love her, love wisdom, and she will watch over you. The beginning of wisdom is this. Get wisdom, though it cost all you have, get understanding. Cherish her, and she will exalt you. Embrace her, and she will honor you. She will give you a garland to grace your head, and present you with a glorious crown. Again, he goes on saying, listen, my son, accept what I say. It's interesting, the first part he said sons. So now maybe on this part, he actually took one son aside. Just a thought. Listen, my son, accept what I say, and the years of your life will be many. Do you know that it's up to us concerning the longevity of our life on this earth? It's really up to us. He said, I instruct you in the way of wisdom and lead you along straight paths. When you walk, your steps will not be hampered. And when you run, you will not stumble. Hold on to instruction and don't let it go. Guard it well, for it is your life. Do not set your foot on the path of wicked or walk in the way of evildoers. Avoid it. Do not travel on it. Turn from it and go your way. For they cannot rest until they do evil. They are robbed of sleep till they make someone stumble. They eat the bread of wickedness and drink the wine of violence. The path of the righteous is like the morning sun, shining ever brighter till the full light of day. But the way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know what makes them stumble. My son, pay attention to what I say. Turn your ears to my words. Do not let them out of your sight. Keep them within your heart, for they are life to those who find them, and health to one's whole body. Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Keep your mouth free from perversity. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Give careful thought to the paths for your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or to the left. Keep your foot from evil. And everybody said amen? Okay, let's bow our heads and let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. We thank you for wisdom. Thank you for the wisdom that was sent from heaven to Solomon to write these words to bless us even today and to guide us in the ways and the path that you have for us. I ask you to enlighten us today. I ask you to illuminate the path that you have for us and give us wisdom so that we don't stumble and we don't hamper the will of God for our lives as far as moving forward in 2017 and doing what you want us to do concerning the steps that you've laid out for us ahead of time. We pray that in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Now there's six things that will take you out of the race. That's what I want to talk about this morning. According to Proverbs chapter 4, six things that will take you off course, out of the race, that Solomon was teaching his son. Now, I believe the word of God is pertinent and relevant to us today, and our Heavenly Father treats us as sons and daughters, so he's in the house today teaching us through his word. The Holy Spirit, the great teacher that he sent us, he's teaching us, and individually, he knows every single one of you. He knows your name, he knows everything about you, and he's already laid out a path for you as individuals. So God wants to illuminate your heart and illuminate your mind according to what path he's laid out for you so that you don't stumble and you don't fall, and so that you continue moving forward and not go backwards. So six things that will take you out of the race. The first one is this. Number one, forgetting instruction. Forgetting instruction. There's a couple things. The Bible talks about forgetting the things that are behind. Right? That's one thing we're supposed to forget, but we're not supposed to forget the instruction that's been given to us. According to his word, according to all the teaching that we've received over the years. The messages, the sermons, the Bible studies, the things that you feed on during the week. Different podcasts, different things. Don't forget that instruction. Remember the lessons of the past, right? Because the school of experience is not the best school to attend, right? So remember the lessons of the past, especially remember the lessons and the mistakes of others so that you don't make the same mistake. That's pretty much why the Bible was written. The whole Old Testament is a testament and a testimony of people's lives that made mistakes. Hopefully they corrected their mistakes and God continued to use them and thrust them forward. So that the whole Bible was given to us as an instruction book so we don't make the same mistakes. But what's amazing to me, it's amazing how many people don't know the Bible. Or they don't know the Bible stories. Or they've never read that portion of scripture. So that might be a good goal this year to actually read through the whole Bible from cover to cover. It's always a good goal if you've never done that before. But what's amazing about the Holy Spirit, he not only instructs us on things, but in those things that he instructs us in, he brings them back to our remembrance when we need them. Did you ever notice that? He'll say, remember that Sunday when Pastor Bob said, or remember that devotional that you read a few years ago. He'll bring things supernaturally back to your remembrance. Because really, we have a limited capacity to remember, but he has unlimited capacity. So he brings things back to your remembrance. Amen? I mean, I can remember things way back when in my childhood. He'll bring things back to my remembrance. He'll bring things to me that my mother said. You ever notice that? Or my dad said, you know? Just giving you wisdom for your life. He'll bring things back to my remembrance of what happened to me in my past concerning people witnessing to me. I'll never forget the two young guys witnessing to me at the beach, Hampton Beach, New Hampshire, and telling me about being born again. And I shrugged it off and told them I was Catholic and I didn't believe in all that garbage. But God used that over the years. Amen? I wasn't a born-again Catholic, that's for sure. I was just a religious Catholic. But God used that, and that seed was powerful and planted in me, and he brought that back to my remembrance. And all the different things that have happened over my life, all the things of wisdom, and I think that's a prayer that we also need to pray, is God, in the times where I'm struggling, thank you for bringing things back to my remembrance. Thank you for helping me to not make the same mistakes over and over again. Thank you for helping me to be successful and follow the path that you have for me, God. I want nothing but your will. Nothing but your will. As we get older, our culture and society want to tell us that we're losing our mind. Guys out there? Don't believe the lie. Alzheimer's does not belong to you. Can you say amen? As a believer, you can stand on God's word that you have a strong, sound mind. And according to Proverbs chapter 10, the Bible says that the memory of the just is blessed. So stop saying, oh, I'm just so forgetful in my old age. You get what you say. Stop saying it. Start saying, my memory is blessed. I can remember names. I can remember places. I can remember faces. I can remember everything. I'm sharp. Start saying that over yourself. And I will be sharp all the days of my life. I love the testimonies of people that are older in age, in their 90s, and you'll hear their sons or people that I know say, yeah, my dad, he's sharp. You know, he's sharp, and I think that's going to be me. I just saw my friend, Pastor Andy White. He pastors in Chandler, Arizona. Picture of his dad, 93 years old, just yesterday on Facebook, dressed in a tux. He was going dancing. 93 years old, going dancing. All right, come on. And you think to yourself, you look to yourself, and you look at those pictures, and you said, that's me. That'll be me. Want to celebrate life till I'm old and I'm satisfied. Able to dance, able to do whatever, and move on with life. So forgetting instruction will take you out of the race. There are those who purposely want to forget instruction because they don't want to yield their lifestyle to the gospel. Are you out there? People who have been taught all their lives, but grown up in church, and because they don't want to yield their lifestyle to the gospel, they want to purposely forget everything that they've been taught, not knowing that the lifestyle that they're engaged in now currently of sin will eventually cause death in their lives. It's a slow process many times concerning death, but it's a downward spiral off of God's path. Are you guys out there? And we've seen that all happen. And so the Holy Spirit is warning us this morning. We just had an incident happen where a gentleman instantly, unexpectedly died. And we were actually in shock about it. But because of what he has said over the past about the gospel and things and certain things that have happened and the tension that he created in the midst of his own family, we were like, oh my gosh, the Bible is true. The word is true. We have to be so careful to recognize that God's word is not just a book where we gain wisdom from. It is God's word speaking to us personally. It is a book from heaven, and it is true, and the word works both ways. It works both ways. So we have to be so careful to follow that path that God has for us and not forget instruction. The second thing is this: things that will take you out of the race, forsaking wisdom. Forsaking wisdom. It says right there in the book of Proverbs that when we forsake wisdom, there's no protection. Secondly, there's no honor. And thirdly, your life can be shortened. So when we honor wisdom, when we seek wisdom, when we're open for wisdom, there'll be protection, there will be honor, and there'll be long life on the earth. Forsaking wisdom literally is forsaking the word. Not cherishing God's word like we used to. Not reading it like we used to. So we have got to uphold this book as the ultimate truth and not take it lightly. Amen? Forsaking wisdom. Forsaking wisdom. The third thing is this. Things that will take you out of the race. Following crooked paths. Following crooked paths will cause us to stumble. We know that the shortest time to get to a certain point is a straight line, and that crooked paths take us longer to get there, and in the midst of it, we expend more energy. Isn't that true? All of us as parents know, as our kids, we're trying to help them to understand that there's a straight line to follow here. If you continue to go down that path, you're going to spend more money, you're going to expend more energy, and it's going to take you longer to get there. Some parents do know some things. Can all the parents say amen? Amen. And it's only because we want to protect them. We've all stumbled and fell, walking along a trail, you know, walking down the street. Falling is not fun. Falling is not fun. We have Stephanie has a friend who broke his upper arm right here snowboarding the other day. Fell on one of the rails, and the doctors is going to take him at least 2 years for him to be completely 100%. And that if he fell again on that, it's like broke right there. If he fell again, he would lose 80% of his arm's use. Serious, serious break. And so we've all fallen and can't get up, right? One time I was rollerblading down the trail. I used to rollerblade. I stopped doing it. I think after that day, I don't think I ever did it again. But, you know, I thought to myself, I'm so good. I don't need wisdom, which would mean I don't need the elbow pads and the knee pads because I'm good. I'm a rollerblader. I think my wife actually told me, you should probably buy some elbow pads and knee pads. I'm like, I don't need them. I'm not listening to wisdom. You know what I mean? I mean, no, wife equals wisdom, all right? Once your husbands learn that, life will be a lot better. So I fell really bad. I mean, I slid across the pavement. And deep gashes, I was bloody, and it was not good. People actually walked past me while I was laying there, didn't even say a word to me, literally. And I got myself off the pavement. I left a lot of skin there, and I made it home, and I knocked on the door, and I'm literally crying, covered in blood, freaking her out. And it wasn't fun. It took a long time for that skin to reappear and for the pain to go away. If I had only listened to wisdom and had those elbow pads and those knee pads on, it wouldn't have been that bad. But because I didn't, it took me a long time to heal. I don't want to, as far as our spiritual life, I don't want to waste time making stupid mistakes when I could have done something really simple to avoid that. You know what I'm talking about? Just wisdom is so important. And more so these days, I just listen to what people say, because how many know God can speak through anybody? God can speak through unbelief. If God can speak through a donkey, he can speak through an unbeliever. Like, hey, maybe you should do this. I'd be like, okay, is that the Holy Ghost talking? Tried to buy a car yesterday. The Holy Spirit will warn you. Tried to buy a car, a little car for Lisa. And we were down there, and the guy was all happy. He wanted to sell his car, and he deals with cars, and he wanted $2,500. Now, when you put your car or put anything on Craigslist, you never pay what they put on there, you know? Anybody out there? You know, you barter, okay? I want to bargain with you. So after the guy's all happy and we're talking, he's asked me where I'm from and stuff, and he said to me, I'm driving all the way from Beaverton, because he has like a little shop down in Troutdale. And nobody has asked about the car because of the snow, so I haven't sold it yet. So I'll be there in an hour. So we drive down to Troutdale. We meet him there. He's all happy. And I said, okay, at the end, after we drove it around, I said, what's the bottom line? How much you want for this? He goes, $2,500. I'm thinking, $2,500? That's what you had listed it for. You already lost me there. And then he said to me, he said, I got somebody else coming to look at it right after you. I immediately knew, you are a liar. You know when the Holy Spirit says something to you, it'll warn you of certain things? And the Holy Spirit said to me, if he lied about that, he's probably lying about something else. Because you just told me you drove from Beaverton to an hour, and nobody was looking at the car because of the snow. I'm like, I just knew inside, you are a liar. I just left. I'm like, okay, good luck. We'll find the right car. You know, we are surrounded all the time by counsel. And we can choose who we spend time with. Not just with people, but also with what we read and what we watch. So the question this morning is this: will you allow pop culture to influence you and your decision making, or will you put God's word first? Because the goal of Hollywood is to mold you to their thinking and their image, and they're doing a very good job of it. And they won't stop until you stumble. They won't stop until you lower your expectations, or they won't stop until you lower what you believe, until you stumble. And it's demonically influenced many times. The devil is using these things to get us to lower our standards, causing us to stumble and eventually end up in destruction. You know the devil's ultimate goal is to send you to hell, right? It doesn't happen overnight. It doesn't happen, you know, suddenly. It happens little by little. Little by little, these little things are infiltrating our mind. We've got to be wise as serpents, yet harmless as doves. We've got to be careful what we watch, be careful what we take in, be careful what we allow in our eye gate and in through our ear gate. Because you can tell me that is not affecting you. You can tell me that music you're listening to, young people, 24/7 is not affecting you. It will eventually affect you. Number four, things that hinder us in our race is walking the path with the wicked. Walking the path with the wicked. And basically, it says this. I've already talked about it a little bit here. The scripture said, violence and wickedness, those who are wicked won't sleep until they make someone stumble. That's their goal. Have you ever met somebody who isn't serving God, that was serving God, and it's very uncomfortable being around them because one of their goals is to make you like they are? They want to lower you down to their level, and you feel uncomfortable being around them. You have to be very careful. It's our job to influence them, not them influence us. So you got to be very careful who you hang around with. Your friends, show me your friends and who you're hanging around with, and I will show you where you'll be at in 10 years. Because if you're constantly hanging around the wrong people, eventually you'll let your guard down. Eventually, you'll take that drink where you used to be free from alcohol, where you used to have freedom in those areas. All of a sudden, they have influenced you instead of them influencing them. Doesn't mean we don't want to hang around with people. It's our job to be the light of the world. But that doesn't mean we have to be best friends with the world. Number five is this, not looking straight ahead. Not looking straight ahead. You remember what happened to Lot's wife when she didn't look straight ahead? Lot's wife turned around. She turned to a pillar of salt. Why was that? Because the world was in her. She was more emotionally attached to the sin that surrounded her and her lifestyle than she was to serving God. She wanted to look back. She was emotionally enthralled by that. And we can't allow ourselves to get that far. We have got to look straight ahead. Amen? But instead of doing what they know to do, they moan. You know, they're stargazers. There's so many believers wasting time, envious of someone else's race instead of their own race, instead of looking ahead. I just want to encourage you that whatever you have to do, whatever you are doing, and you know that it's right and you know that it's good, then gear up 100% and go for it. See the end goal, whether it's 10 years, 20 years down the road, go for it. And don't stop. Do it with everything that you've got. You know on the inside it's right. Amen? And stop looking for the easy way out. Can all the parents say amen? Stop looking for the easy way out. Anything worth something is not easy. It's going to take struggle. It's going to take heartache. It's going to take, you know, being outside building machines, right, Larry? When it's 5 degrees, when you don't want to be outside. It's going to take doing things you don't want to do. Amen? There's many things that I don't want to do physically. I don't want to be out here doing this. I don't want to be out here in this cold. I don't want to be out here building this. I don't want to be out here fixing this. But guess what? I don't want to pay someone else to do it. I'm going to find out and figure it out myself, right? There's wisdom. God, give me wisdom on how to do this. Show me how to save money. How many know God's a good money saver? He's a good conservative money saver. He will save you money. He will send you down a path of success concerning financial things. He's the God of the good deals, right? Amen. My motto, don't ever pay retail for anything. Stop looking. I don't know why we're raising a generation that's looking for the easy way out. Put your hand to do something. So what if you're going to get dirty? Anybody ever watch the show Dirty Jobs? It's a great show. That is true. That is exactly right. Nobody wants to do those jobs anymore. Because we've glamorized other jobs instead of these jobs. And you know what? All of the labor jobs in America right now, I'm telling you, you can make a lot of money if you're into doing plumbing, electrical, because nobody wants to do those jobs anymore. Because they're looking for the easy way out. Looking to sit at a desk at a computer a couple hours a day, hopefully going to make $50 an hour doing whatever, programming this, you know, developing video games. Hello? Come on now. There's so much money to be made out there if you're just willing to get your hands dirty and not look for the easy way out. Not pushing through school to the end. Not getting that degree, you know? Not doing whatever it takes in order to get down that road and get down that path. Live like no one else now so you can live like no one else in the future. Basically. And the last thing is this. As we end this morning, is not being steadfast. Not being steadfast. You need to think to yourself, what is the end goal? If God told you to do something and he hasn't said anything else concerning your future, then that is the will of God for you. Don't quit it. Keep doing it. No matter how it looks, you may think to yourself, I've done this for so long, it doesn't seem to be that successful. You know, and you can wage a war in your mind concerning what success is and what success isn't. Success basically is doing the will of God for your life. So whatever he has told you to do, if you know it was the voice of God, maybe you've put that aside, pick it back up, look straight ahead, get steadfast in it, and engage and move forward with it. Be committed to it. Maybe the only reason why it hasn't been successful is because you've been doing it half-heartedly. Amen? Do it with everything you got. Re-engage. Rethink it through. Re-pray it through. And when you do, what happens? God will begin to open up your eyes concerning the end goal. He'll show you glimpses of the future. He'll encourage you. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He encourages you to move forward, encourages you not to quit. Speak it, stick to it, believe it, and run that race, and don't quit. Don't be hindered by these other things. Set those things aside and be focused. Focused on the goal, focused on moving ahead. Don't quit. You don't want to be known as a quitter. Amen? Shoulda, coulda, woulda. The best way is the way that God made for you. So just to review, this is a great read, Book of Proverbs, this week. A great family message from Solomon teaching his son and passing on these words of wisdom from generation to generation, from David to Solomon to his son and sons. But he's warning us and giving us wisdom concerning the race that he has for us. Number one, six things that will take you out of the race. Number one is forgetting instruction. Number two, forsaking wisdom. Number three, following crooked paths. Number four, walking the path of the wicked. Number five, not looking straight ahead. And number six, not being steadfast. Good practical teaching this morning. And if there's some things that you need to change and tweak and some things you need to ask God to forgive you, then do so this morning before we leave. Amen? Let's all stand up. I instruct you in the way of wisdom and lead you along straight paths. It says, walk your steps so that you will not be hampered, and when you run, don't stumble. This is where I got all this from. And then verse 14, do not set your foot on the path of the wicked or walk in the way of evildoers. And then verse 18, the path of the righteous is like the morning sun, shining ever brighter till the full light of day. But the way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They don't even know what makes them stumble. And then verse 25, let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze before you. Verse 26, give careful thought to the paths for your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. Another book of Proverbs said, don't look to the right or don't look to the left. Keep looking forward and moving ahead. Because the right and the left, a lot of times, they're either, the right could be successes and the left can be failures. And it's not always failures that stop you in your race. Sometimes it's past successes. And you think to yourself, I could never duplicate that again. That was my glory days. No, the Bible says, and we sang about it, we go from glory to glory. God has more for you. Sure, you were successful in your past, and you can keep that as your only success, or you can take a risk and move forward and keep running your race and look forward to the next glory and the next glory and the next success and the next thing that God has for you. Basically, what God is saying this morning is, I don't want you to be stuck and unsatisfied. I created you to be satisfied and created you to live life to the fullest. Abundant, precious, amazing, adventurous, fulfilling life on this earth. That's what our Heavenly Father, as Solomon sat with his son, our Heavenly Father sits with us today, his sons and daughters, and says, this is what I want for you. I'm going to help you do it too. I'll be with you, never leave you. I'll continue to encourage you to walk that straight path, that straight line, and move forward with your life. Remember, we run not this way. We run forward. You know, you never see anybody running down the street. Oh, look at, they're running for exercise. Moving forward. That's why we don't have eyes in the back of our head, right? You ever notice that you can't even turn your head and look behind? Only your mother had eyes in the back of her head. No, for my mother, it was called the rear view mirror. Right? I don't know how, when she was driving that old Ford station wagon with the paneling on the side, I don't know how she saw us, but her arm was like double long anybody else's arm. She would reach back there and bam, 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 stop it. That's when we didn't have to wear seat belts back then, so we could crawl from the second seat to the third seat and she couldn't get us, you know. That's why we only went on one vacation a year and it was only an hour's drive away. We never went anywhere else. She couldn't handle us driving that long. Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. So Father God, come on, let's raise our hands. We appreciate you. Thank you for the wisdom from heaven that was downloaded into Solomon's life, and now we take advantage of that today. Lord, we don't take the warnings lightly. We accept instruction. Forgive us for our pride and our been there, done that, know-it-all attitude, God. That attitude will hinder us from ever moving forward in our lives. So forgive us for pride, God. Lord, we worship you today and we thank you, Lord. We ask you for wisdom. You said if anybody needs wisdom to ask, and you would give it to us liberally. So God, we ask you for wisdom this morning for our families, for our marriages, for our lives, for our schools, for our schoolwork. We ask you for wisdom for our future, for our jobs, for our businesses, for all the talents that you've given us. Lord, do we stay at this job, or is there another job for us where we can make more money, God? I thank you for opening up our minds and opening up doors of opportunities, God, for unprecedented blessing and advance in our lives. And we thank you for that, God. Lord, forgive us for taking on thoughts, Lord, that aren't biblical, that aren't your word. Forgive us for following down the path, Lord, that we know is a crooked path that is going to end up in destruction. We don't want to follow that path, Lord. Help us to get on the right path this morning. Help us to follow you. Help us to cherish your word and allow that wisdom from your word to penetrate our hearts and minds and renew our thinking concerning what we need to do and where we need to go. Your will, oh God, not our will, be done. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. I'm going to ask if you got prayer guys, prayer team, come on up. If anybody needs specific prayer this morning concerning things that are going on in your life, you want us to agree. The Bible says if two or more agree as touching anything that they ask, it will be done by our Father in heaven. Sometimes you just need someone else to hold hands with you and agree with you concerning what you're going through. And if you'd like to pray that prayer of agreement this morning, we'd be so glad to pray with you. I want to thank you for coming. I hope that you'll show up on Wednesday night. If not for youth, then for prayer on Wednesday night up here. And I want you to have a fantastic week. We love you, and we're praying for your race on a regular basis. Thank you so much for coming to City Park Church. Have a great day off tomorrow if you have a holiday tomorrow. And let's all get back to work on Tuesday. Yeah. Turn to somebody, shake their hand, give them a high five, tell them you love them, and you are for them and praying for them this week.